Billy Joel once wrote, "Don't go changing to try and please me. You never let me down before. Don't imagine you're too familiar and I don't see you anymore. I wouldn't leave you in times of trouble. We never could have come this far. I took the good times. I'll take the bad times. I'll take you just the way you are." Friends, welcome to Long's Peak United Methodist Church. We're so glad that you've decided to join us today for worship. If today is your first time joining us, we welcome you with open arms. And if today is the 999th time, we welcome you. We are so just overjoyed that you're here. Friends, Reverend Jeremiah in his sermon later today is going to be talking about God throwing us a banquet. And we are the honored guests. Let's talk about how we are the ones that have to respond to God's invitation to us. Let's stick around and find out what that's all about. Welcome to worship.
Good morning, Long's Peak. I hope you are having a great day. I have exciting news. We are all gonna go to a party. Are you so excited? I love parties. So, I want you to think about, what are you gonna bring to the party? I'm gonna bring music, because I like to dance at parties. That's what I'm gonna bring. What are you gonna bring?
Queso dip.
Excellent. What are you going to bring?
I'm bringing my fancy dance moves to go along with your awesome music.
Oh. I love that. What are you gonna bring?
Balloons!
There are so many things that we can bring and share with other people. Last week, I talked about how being able to share things that you love makes it more fun. God loves you. God is proud of you. God made you special. And each of us are special. And when all of our gifts come together, it can make something great. Come with me. Let's go. Come see. So, stained glass. Look at all of these fancy pieces of glass. This is my favorite. Look at this. It changes color. I think that's really neat. Now, each of you told me what you're going to bring to the party. And each of us are different. So come closer. Come see. Look at this. All of these pieces are different. And when you put all these pieces together, it makes something beautiful. Remember to spread love, choose kind, and we'll see you next time.
Please join me in a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Creator of heaven and earth, you who transcends the world, always omnipotent, omnipresent, and omniscient. You are the one who knows our hearts and has shaped us through your gifts and your blessings. We come to you seeking your peace, your forgiveness, and your love. For we, your creations, are seldom in unity, ungrateful, and selfish. Our world seems so lost in 2020 while we are facing the coronavirus pandemic, fighting massive fires around the globe and near our homes, and suffering with political and racial divisions that seem unresolvable. Let us not forget in these times that you remain with us and enable us to help and love one another. We ask you to give us courage, strength, wisdom, and peace by cleansing our hearts with your Holy Spirit. Bless our leaders as they guide us through the challenges of this year. Watch over our healthcare workers, our teachers, our community service officers, and our firefighters. Heal our hearts, unify us in your love. Help us to recognize those opportunities to glorify your name so that we may more perfectly love you as you have loved us. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Friends, we are so richly blessed. By now, you have likely received in your mailbox a letter from the Finance Committee at Longs Peak United Methodist Church, and included in that is a green card. That card is for you to prayerfully consider what gifts you can offer to God in this next year in helping us to plan our budget. But in addition to that, and perhaps even more importantly than that, on the back of that card is a place for you to share your vision for Longs Peak United Methodist Church in the year to come. And in this week ahead, we are really hoping that you will share those with us in so that we can share them with one another. If you will share your vision with us by returning your card or sharing in the website, or by giving us a call or even an email, if you'll share that with us in this coming week, we will then also share it in the coming days as we build up to All Saints Day. And so friends, we are glad that you are part of our congregation, and we are glad that you're sharing your gifts with us. Let's listen to this next song.
All of you is more than enough for all of me, for every thirst and every need, you satisfy me with your love, and all I have in you is more than.
Today's scripture is Psalm 23. I'll be reading from the New King James Version, a psalm of David. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. you anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
There are some folks that are they get pretty creative with their wedding invitation RSVPs. I thought I'd share a couple examples with you. One of them reads, "The favor of a reply is quite kindly requested by May 5th. Your options: check, enthusiastically intend, regretfully decline, regretfully intend, or enthusiastically decline." Another wedding invitation says, "We look forward to celebrating with you. Please check one of the following. We'll be there with bells on. We'll be there free of bells. We'll be there undecided on bells. We'll not be there, heard that there will be people wearing bells. We'll not be there regardless of the bell controversy." And one final one which reads, "If you do not RSVP by October 1st and still plan on attending, please bring your own chair and a sandwich." Well, friends, today we're going to be talking about RSVP, responding to the invite. This will be our last sermon in our stewardship sermon series on how to live the abundant life. And today we're going to be talking about how God provides us with an invitation. God has prepared a great banquet feast before us. And our job is to respond. Our job is to RSVP to that invitation. The passage that Greg shared with us just a little bit ago was the 23rd Psalm. And I like to look at this psalm in three parts. There's kind of three sections if you break it down. The first section is in the third person in the way that the author is referring to God. It's also a passage about, that section is about shepherds. The language you hear, "The Lord is my shepherd," says that in the very first line. "I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures and leads me beside still waters, restores my soul, and he leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake." So this is this idea of God as a shepherd, that God is watching over our needs. God is a source of a protection. The green pastures, it symbolizes or sounds like fields and the cool waters. These are all this notion of that we are the part of the flock. We are one of God's sheep. And then the second shift or the second chunk of this scripture changes from that third person shepherd to now the author says, "You," speaking directly to God. "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me." Again, we still have the language of a shepherd. The staff, the rod, of course, these are tools of the shepherd. And then it goes on, it says, "You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forevermore." See, now the imagery has shifted. Now we're no longer talking about sheep in the field. The relationship is not like God protecting the sheep. Rather, now God is hosting this amazing party. You know, we're talking about the table being prepared in the presence of my enemies, and my cup overflows. This is very different than the idea of God as just this shepherd protecting. Rather, God is inviting us into something very beautiful. And then it continues with the final chunk of the passage is the benediction. "Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." So this is the benediction. This is the promise that this great invitation that God's laying out before us is available for us the rest of our lives. The point in this psalm that I'd like to lift up this morning is that you are the guest of honor. God has prepared this great banquet feast called life, and you are invited into the abundance of this feast. Let's talk a little bit about some of the imagery, the imagery of extravagance of abundance in this passage. The first is, there's a table prepared before me in the presence of my enemies. Now, this might be like the victory meal of a conquered battle, right? When you're celebrating what you have won. And that language continues with, my cup overflows. It sets the table of a banquet feast. Now, as Methodists, I know that we've all been to some pretty good potlucks. We've seen some pretty good spreads in our day. But I want to think about the abundance, the way that God is just extraordinarily extravagant, pulling off just life's bounty before us. I want to share with you what a real potluck looks like. So this is a banquet feast that was given in 1455 in the court of Anjou, Count of Anjou. That's the third son of King Louis II. Here's the menu for that evening. Course 1, a civet of hare, a quarter of stag brined in salt, a stuffed chicken, and a loin of veal. Course 2, dishes covered with German sauce, gilt sugar plums, pomegranate seeds, two enormous pies, each one surmounted with smaller pies to represent the crown. Each pie contains a whole deer, a gosling, three capons, six chickens, 10 pigeons, one rabbit, stuffing made from minced loin of veal, 2 pounds of fat, 26 hard-boiled eggs covered with saffron and flavored with cloves. Now, courses 3, 4, and 5 contain a roe deer, a pig, a sturgeon cooked in parsley and vinegar covered with powdered ginger, a kid goat, 2 goslings, 12 chickens, 12 pigeons, 6 rabbits, 2 herons, 1 fat capon stuffed, 4 chickens covered with egg yolk and sprinkled with spice, a wild boar, wafers with jelly, part red and part white, representing the crests of the honored guests, that's you, covered with fennel seed, preserved in white cream sugar. Also, cheese in slices, strawberries, plums stewed in rose water, and wines in vogue at the time, followed by a sorbet of Tums and Pepto-Bismol. That is a feed, and that is the abundance that God pours out for us. We're talking about this banquet feast. It's a metaphor for our lives. It's a metaphor for memories and career goals and successes and things we're prideful of and family and loved ones and friends and all of these beautiful things that money can't buy. That is the abundance placed before us on the banquet table. And friends, you are the honored guest. You are asked to be the guest of honor. You know, a lot of times we look at the 23rd Psalm as words that provide comfort in a time of grief. It's often read at funerals. But this psalm can also guide our lives in the now, in the joy, in the beauty of God's creation and the love that God shares for us. And we're calling this banquet feast life. As I said, this is a metaphor. God doesn't really pour oil on our heads. Rather, our job is to accept all the wonderful things in life as children of God. And we might question, there's times that we don't feel particularly worthy of being such guests at a banquet feast. So you might ask why. It's because you are a child of God. When you had life breathed into you, that divine breath of light has the sacred in it. You are created in God's image. There's nothing you can do. There's nothing you can do to earn this. God loves you and invites you to the feast. You may remember the story Shrek if your grandparents that babysit your grandchildren, or if you're young parents, no doubt you're familiar with this animated show, Shrek. It's about an ogre who lives in a swamp, and he goes on this mission to rescue a princess Fiona. And in the course of the story, it turns out that Princess Fiona, at night, she turns into an ogre herself. There's been a curse that's been placed on her. And it's said that when she finds her one true love, the curse will be broken, and she will just be the most beautiful thing. Well, she falls in love with Shrek at the end of the movie, and they kiss, and it's Shrek is her true love, and there's this amazing light, and there's a transforming happening. And instead of turning into that beautiful princess, she transforms into her persona as an ogre. And she's confused by this. Princess Fiona says, "But I thought I was supposed to be beautiful." And Shrek says, "But you are beautiful." See, they're both ogres, but they were made in the same image. The beauty was a beauty because who they were at their very essence reflected each other. Friends, that's how we are as children of God. Because God has breathed life into us, we are God's honored guest at the banquet feast. And sure, there are times in our lives that we might feel a little bit like ogres. Maybe we've done something that we don't really be proud of. Maybe it's that we have said something that we're ashamed of. These are the things that keep us from accepting that invitation. But you know what? The invitation is a standing invitation. It's already been made. God is saying, "You are beautiful because you are mine. You're invited to the feast." So then the imagery, this imagery of extravagance continues, and it talks about, "You anoint my head with oil." We don't do that these days. We, you know, when a president-elect takes the stand, no one comes up and puts oil on their head. But 3,000 years ago, to be anointed with oil, it was a special honor. It was a sign of something very great, that you were the honored guest. Typically, this was reserved for kings on their coronation or prophets as they were becoming ordained into what they were doing. But also, if there was a very fancy feast, it might be upon the host of that feast to seat the guest at a place of honor. And anointing that guest before the other gathered was a way of outwardly showing that this is the honored guest of this feast. And that's what God is saying. God is anointing us and saying that you are honored guests at this abundance of life poured out before you. Do you have any idea how valuable you are to God? It's an interesting question to think about, especially if we're going to try to break it down into a monetary sum. Heard this amazing story that in 2011, there was a woman in Defiance, Ohio, and she had lived in the same house forever. She passed away without having any children of her own, so she left the estate to her nieces and nephews. And as the nieces and nephews are going through the home and they're getting the estate in order, one of the things they found in the attic was a green cardboard box. And opening up that cardboard box was over 700 baseball cards tied together with some twine. They figured the cards might have a little bit of value, didn't think too much of it, took a few weeks to get the cards appraised. It turns out that those 700 baseball cards were multiple sets of a very rare series from 1910 that collectors call an E98 series. And there were 30 cards per set. Half of those 30 featured players are now baseball Hall of Famers. One of the rarest cards from this E98 set is a Ty Cobb card. Prior to finding these cards in the attic, the best known Ty Cobb was rated on an 8. Baseball card graders use a scale of 1 to being poor and 10 being mint condition, and the best known Ty Cobb was an 8. There were multiple copies of this same card that rated as tens. These were uncirculated baseball cards. It turns out that the woman's father had owned a grocer at the turn of the century, and would get these promotional cards from the vendor coming into the store, and he chucked them in a box, and that's as far as they went. Well, the family chose out of these 700 to sell just 37 cards. Those cards went to auction and sold for a sum of $566,000. $500,000 for a piece of paper. The remaining cards are estimated at being a value of $1.5 to $3 million. So the question is some dirty old baseball cards in the attic are worth so much money, how much more are you worth? You've got a soul. You've got a light within you. You are flesh and blood. You are animated. You are in God's spirit. How much more valuable are you if a baseball card can be worth so much? The next extravagant piece that comes out of this passage is the terminology of my cup overflows. Again, this is the banquet feast analogy, and this shows this extravagance, this luxuriousness, that we're not talking about a little splash of wine in the glass. No, we're pouring from the jug and the glass overflows. This is not the frugality of a stingy host. This is a host that wants to generously pour out to that host's friends. And God pours these blessings into us. We tend to look at our blessings through material things. We think we're richly blessed when we have a jet boat and our own personal airplane and a house and the latest cell phone that comes out. And all of these things are our superficial blessings. The great banquet feast that I am talking about today is the blessings spread out on the table that we've talked about. Joys, fulfillment, spiritual wholeness, experiences, career success, pride in hobbies, and most importantly, are our relationships, our family, our friends, our dearest loved ones, even our pets. These are the most important blessings that are lavishly poured out upon us. There's a story that has been in many sermons. It's probably already been preached in this church before, but I think it illustrates the value of friends. There was an old man who had attended a church for many years, and after his wife died, he just quit going to church. And he kind of withdrew from society. He stayed home, became a hermit. People of the congregation would invite him over for dinner, and he would always politely decline, say, "I don't think so this time." And he just never got beyond the house. And one day the pastor knocked at his door, and the man invited the pastor in, and the man had been sitting by the fire. He invited the pastor to come over and sit down in front of the hearth with him. And the two of them sat there looking at the fireplace for quite some time. They were just watching the flames dance, and not a word was spoken. And finally, the pastor got up, and he took a pair of tongs next to the fire, and he picked out this bright, hot, yellow, glowing ember. And he took it from the fire and he set it off on the far edge of the hearth. And as they sat there and watched that glowing ember, it went from a bright yellow to a red to a pale orange to a pink and then gray and just kind of fizzled out. And they looked at that dead coal for a while. After a few moments, the pastor got up, took the fire tongs, and put that ember back at the fire, and once again, immediately, it was aglow. It was bright, as though it had never been removed from the fire. Without saying a word, the pastor sat back down. The man looked over to him. He said, "Point well taken. Thanks for the fiery sermon. I'll see you next Sunday." What this tells us is that we can't live outside of community. Our greatest blessing, our greatest abundance is our family, our friends, our support as a congregation. Without one another, we fizzle out. We need each other to just experience the best of things. As a church, we carry each other through times of deep grief and trauma, and we celebrate with each other times of success, weddings, graduations. We need each other. This is one of the things that the church offers us. You know, we can have great friendships on the golf course or at the Rotary Club or at whatever club you attend, but the depth of the relationships that we have in church, the depth of the conversations that we have, when we know each other's struggles and losses, when we celebrate our gains, these are great abundance, blessings. These are things that we just, money can't provide that amount. There's a classic comic of Peanuts, and Charlie Brown goes to Lucy for psychiatric help, and he says, "What do you do when you don't fit in? What can you do when life seems to be passing you by?" Well, Lucy leads Charlie away from her booth, and she says, "Follow me. I want to show you something. See the horizon over there? See how big the world is? See how much room there is for everybody? Have you ever seen any other worlds?" Charlie meekly responds, "No." Well, she continues, "As far as I know, this is the only world, right?" Even more meekly, Charlie Brown says, "Right." Lucy presses on, "There are no other worlds for you to live in, right?" Charlie admits, "Right." "You were born to live in this world, right?" "Right," says Charlie. Then Lucy explodes, "Well, then live in it! 5 cents, please." That's the invitation. God has blessed us into this life, into this world. God has poured out this great banquet feast, this extravagance before us of experience, of joy. And God is offering us this invitation, this RSVP, saying, "Won't you be my honored guest at this table?" Amen.
Bruno Mars wrote these words, friends. "When I see your face, there's not a thing that I would change. 'Cause you're amazing, just the way you are. And when you smile, the whole world stops and stares for a while. 'Cause you're amazing, just the way you are." Friends, God is throwing us a banquet. I pray that we'll enthusiastically RSVP to be there with bells on. An open chair and bountiful meal is greater than any sandwich you'll ever eat is being provided. Let's go in peace. Amen.